Good Sunday to you. This is Ron Mead with Meek Street Church of Christ, and we're here today, this Sunday, July the 25th, and we're talking about God's Word in a way that will help us to grow and be faithful to God, as God wants us to talk about His Word and His ways, and be able to talk about the things that are freely given to us by God in a way that helps us to know that there is a God that we need to serve and be faithful to Him in all things. Our lesson today is talking about God, talking about the faithfulness of God. That's our title for our lesson today. And it's taken from Lamentations chapter 3. I want to go over to the Lamentations 3 and read what the Bible says in this particular reading. Verses 22 and verse 23 says, "The Lord's loving kindness indeed never ceases, for His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And that's a psalm that we sing. Great is your faithfulness, or thy faithfulness. And it talks about how God is. He's one who's dependable, the one we can depend upon in all circumstances. He's faithful to us. And let's look at what that means. First of all, what is faithfulness? That character of God that is, you might say, one that makes God God, is the fact that He is dependable and faithful to us. Well, if we look at simply the American College Dictionary, we'll find that faithfulness, first of all, means strict or thorough in the performance of a duty. So we think about someone who's a faithful worker, a faithful servant, maybe someone who is called upon to do something in any situation, a son or daughter, in whatever their capacity they're called upon to serve the family. They have to be faithful in whatever charge. And we understand what that means, is that we have to fully and thoroughly do what's required of us. Then there is the second definition of this, is that true to one's words, promise, vows, and so forth. We think about wedding vows, and we think about promises that we make all the time, maybe parents to the children or children to the parents, about different things they'll do, things they're going to honor, and they have to be faithful in what they say. Or it could be full of or showing loyalty and fidelity. That refers to the idea again of being loyal to someone or something. And we have to be faithful in whatever charge we're given as children of God. And also, here's more maybe the passive side of this, that may be relied upon, trusted, or believed. That refers to faithfulness as well. Something that we can rely upon, trust, like God's word itself is to be trusted. And we come to the Greek word, pistos, refers to the idea of faithfulness here. It's the word faith. We get that idea of learning to be faithful and dependable when it comes to things that we do in service to God. And it is a verbal adjective used in two senses. We look at the first of this, which is passive. We think about how it's part of our lives. It's a passive thing that we really don't have to actively show. It's to be faithful, to be trusted, reliable. When somebody you know is dependable and trustworthy, then you say, well, I can trust so-and-so. And I know they're always going to do what they say they're going to do. Like our word is our bond. And that's the way it should be. Our word is something we ought to give and say, this is what I intend to do, and I'm going to do whatever it is I say I'm going to. That's faithfulness, isn't it? Then signifying believing, trusting, relying. That's active. Think about the idea of how we and God believes us when we say we're going to do the things we do and we fulfill that. There's a sense of mutual faith with that relationship in that way. But it's talking about mainly toward God in that way. I often think about how there's mottos that are out there. And the Marines, they developed a motto, Semper Fi, which is Latin for always faithful. What they were trying to do was try to have the motto that reflects upon the Marine Corps. And they wanted something to sum up what they were and the character of those Marines trying to secure our nation and do what they can to fight for freedom and such. And so they chose always faithful. It's like someone is always at their post, always there, ready for the time that's called upon to defend the nation or whatever type of situation it is. And think about God in the extreme passage of that. Think about Him in the sense of God is really the only one that can truly be said that He's always faithful, because there's never a time He's caught sleeping. There's never a time that He has let anyone down when they need to be having some kind of help in some way, that God is there for them. Then the faithfulness of God is declared in Scripture. That's one of the things the Bible tells us, that we can trust God. In the Old Testament, it said in Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 9, here the Bible says, "Know therefore that the Lord your God, He is God, the faithful God, who keeps His covenant and His loving kindness to a thousandth generation with those who love Him and keep His commandments." And that says a lot about our God, the fact that He is the one we can trust, the faithful God. And that's what the Old Testament is declaring. Moses is saying about God. In Lamentations chapter 3, I want to use more than just those two verses, verse 22 and 23. Let's back up to verse 19 and kind of get the context. And here is Jeremiah has suffered a lot, and he's doing the will of God as being a prophet of God to God's own people, who were rejected a lot of things. They were scorning him. They put him to derision. And yet in verse 19, we pick up, says, here Jeremiah says, "Remember my affliction and my wandering, wormwood and bitterness. Surely my soul remembers and is bowed down within me. This I recall to my mind. Therefore I have hope." Notice that he says hope. What is Jeremiah's hope? He says, "The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And the conclusion of that is in verse 24. Verse 24 tells, "The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I have hope in him." And that says a lot about our hope and trust. Who do we depend upon when we're suffering, when we're going through hard and difficult times? It needs to be the Lord, because he is one we can put our hope and our trust in, because he is faithful. And the Bible tells us in many situations that is the case. Now take your Bibles to Psalm chapter 89. And I want to read some passages here that David wrote down for us. And he's talking about the faithfulness of God. He's actually extolling the faithfulness of God in those passages. Let's read in verse 1. It says, "I will sing of the loving kindness of the Lord forever. To all generations I will make known your faithfulness with my mouth. For I've said, loving kindness will be built up forever. In the heavens you will establish your faithfulness. I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn to David my servant, I will establish your seed forever and build up your throne to all generations." This is God's covenant with David. David was one who was a faithful servant of God, but also God's is also, let's say, the ultimate in faithfulness. Notice verse 5 says, "The heavens will praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness also in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies is comparable to the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty is like the Lord? A God greatly feared in the council of the holy ones, and awesome above all those who are around him. O Lord, God of hosts, who is like you, O mighty Lord?" Here he's talking about the wonderful reasons why we can trust God, because he is far beyond man and so much superior to man. He goes on to say, "Your faithfulness also surrounds you. You rule the swelling of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them. You yourself crushed Rahab like one who was slain. You scattered your enemies with your mighty arm. The heavens are yours. The earth also is yours. The world and all it contains. You have founded them. The north and the south, you have created them. Tabor and Hermon shout for joy at your name. You have a strong arm. Your hand is mighty. Your right hand is exalted. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne." There's a lot to be said about the character of God and why he's faithful, because he's righteous and he is just and he will do justice. And that's why we can put our hope and trust in him in that way. And they go on to say, it says, "Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Loving kindness and truth go before you. How blessed are the people who know the joyful sound. O Lord, they walk in the light of your countenance. In your name they rejoice all the day, and by your righteousness they are exalted." And so we talk about why we can trust. And his character is 100% the reason why. Because he's always there, always faithful, when the people of God cry out and the obedience of them and all that's what we do. God is faithful, can be trusted in everything. David was one who trusted in God, and we can too because of that. Then we come to the New Testament. And here there are reasons why we can trust God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, he talks about temptation, Paul does. He says, no temptation has overtaken you, except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. And that's really something we need. When the devil is throwing everything at us, when he's doing all he can to crush and destroy us by temptations and everything that would cause us to go away from God, in his mind, that's what he wants us to do, what Satan wants us to do. But you know, the fact is God's faithful. And though we have an enemy who's out to destroy us, that's why we can have hope in times of temptation, because God is on our side if we are faithful, if we stay faithful. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23, also the scriptures declare the faithfulness of God there. It says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. Now, what will God do? What will Jesus do? We understand that he's going to preserve us. You know, we understand that we live in this world only a little while, and then we see death. And what keeps us, what saves us? It's the faithfulness of God. God will one day resurrect the faithful ones, be preserved, and we will be saved for eternity because we trusted in God, and his faithfulness in kind is returned to us in some regard because we are his people. And he will do like his son, Jesus. He'll resurrect those who are faithful, preserve us. And that's what we understand that salvation is all about. Going into heaven, that's, you might say, the ultimate salvation of the child of God. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 to 13, here is a passage that Paul was speaking to young Timothy. He says, this is a faithful saying, for if we died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. That's the good part of this. Now look at the last part. It says, if we deny him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. And so even if we, on our side of the coin, if our side of the stick, you might say, if we're unfaithful, God's still going to be faithful. He's still going to be dependable upon those who will trust in him. That's why we should want to put our confidence and our dependability on him in everything. As we look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 19, again, the scriptures declare the faithfulness of God. He says, therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to him in doing good as to a faithful creator. You know, God made all things, and he made all the sun, the moon, the stars, all the universe, the creative work of God, and he is faithful in that. Everything goes just like clockwork, as the designer, like a watch that's made and it has a purpose and a design. This universe does also. And we, if we suffer, do we understand that there is someone, because we can look at all the universe, the heavens declare the glory of God and know that there's a faithful creator that we can trust and put our dependability in him as well. Now I want to look at some promises. You know, it's one thing to say that God is trustworthy, he's faithful. It's another thing entirely to demonstrate that. You know, we can tell a husband to his wife that I love you, I love you, I love you. But until that love is demonstrated, those words are meaningless, just lip service. But God's demonstration of his faithfulness is more than just saying it. It's about doing what he does and the promises that he's kept. That's something we can look back on and say, you know, that's exactly why I can trust in God. It's because of what he has done in the past. With the promise of the flood, in Genesis chapter 6, 17 to 19, the Bible says about the promise there, talking to Noah. It says, and behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die, but I will establish my covenant with you. And you shall go into the ark, you and your sons, your wife and your sons' wives with you. And every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every sort into the ark to keep them alive with you. they shall be male and female. And just like we tell our kids the story about Noah, how that God caused Noah to build that ark out of gopher wood, all for the saving of his house, because there was a great flood coming, and it came, as chapter 7, 13 to 19 talks about that as well. Go back there and read the fulfillment of this promise. As God said, there's coming a flood, and lo and behold, it happens just like God said that it would. In verse 13, the Bible says, on the very same day, Noah and Shem and Ham and Japheth, the sons of Noah, and Noah's wife and the three wives of his sons with them entered the ark, they and every beast after its kind, and all the cattle after their kind, and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth after its kind, and every bird after its kind, all sorts of birds. So they went into the ark two by twos of all flesh, and went in which was the breath of life. Go on to say in verse 16, those that entered, male and female of all flesh, entered as God had commanded them, and the Lord closed it behind them. In other words, God shut the door of that ark when everybody was inside of that. And so verse 17, then the flood came upon the earth for 40 days, and the water increased and lifted up the ark so that it rose above the earth. The water prevailed, increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark floated on the surface of the water. The water prevailed more and more upon the earth, so that all the high mountains everywhere under the heavens were covered. And so that tells us again, just like God promised, the flood came. And some were caught aware. We understand Jesus uses that to remind us to always be ready, because the time of Noah was a time people were marrying and giving in marriage until the day that they entered into the ark and God brought the flood. Then there's a promise of the earth remaining. That's one of the great promises of God. Here in Genesis chapter 8, verse 22, after that got off the ark, after finally the waters receded, and Noah builds an altar to the Lord. He worships there. And then here we find this promise in verse 22, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, winter and summer, and day and night shall not cease. In chapter 9, 11 to 16, we won't read all that, but he talks about the rainbow and the promise there, the covenant he makes with mankind, that whenever the rain comes and there's that bow in the sky, that rainbow, that you know the faithfulness of God's word by that very thing, because God keeps his word. There'll never be a flood here on planet Earth that will cover the whole face of the earth like there was in the time of Noah while we're living today, because God's not going to destroy this world again by water. Now, he will do it by fire, as 2 Peter 3 tells us, but it will not be by water that he does this. And then there's the promises given to Abraham that illustrate the faithfulness of God. In Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, again, God speaks to Abraham, says, or Abram says, now the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. He's going to say, and make your name great. And so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. And that's the first time, well, actually the time that God tells Abram about the very covenant, the covenant that he make with him, about having him make a great nation out of him. And all of that tells us the promises. In chapter 15, he talks about that again. He reiterates that and tells Abraham he's going to have that. You're going to have a son, that you don't have to worry about having a son from somebody else. But you'll have a son right out of your own body, and Sarah also. And the Bible tells us in one place that Sarah laughed when she heard about that. And so it was that all this took place. Someone who was past the time of childbearing, both Abraham and his wife Sarah, they conceived and bore Isaac. And Isaac was that promised son that God would give to him. Joshua 23, verse 14. Joshua says, behold, this day I'm going the way of all the earth, and you know in all your hearts and in all your souls that not one good thing has failed of all the good things which the Lord your God spoke concerning you. All have come to pass for you, not one word of them has failed. And that tells us a lot about the faithfulness of God in that passage. Joshua was able to say, this is exactly what is going on. Moses and Joshua both attest to the faithfulness of God. In Galatians 3, verse 16, jumping forward a little bit in our lesson, we talk about Abraham and the seed, which is Christ, as Paul would say. Now, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say as to seeds, that's plural, but as of many, but as of one, and to your seed who is Christ. It's referring to Jesus, would be the lineage of Abraham, the descendant of Abraham, that even Abraham rejoiced to see his day, as that was one of the promises of God. Now we go back to the idea, back a few hundred years back again, the promise of the coming Messiah. Deuteronomy chapter 18, the Bible speaks of here when Moses promised them. He actually prophesied of this. In verse 18 of chapter 18, the Bible says, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And it shall be that whoever will not hear my words, which he speaks in my name, I will require it of him. And talk about what this one Messiah, this prophet, Jesus was fulfillment of that. He was of the coming Messiah. And Isaiah 7 verse 14 talks about the virgin birth that you would have. It says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. And some have argued and said, well, it's talking about a maid. It's not really talking about a virgin, someone who's never had relations with a man, a woman that could conceive without that. But it's actually talking about someone in that way. And there's some have tried to say, well, that's not what Isaiah is saying. But if you look at Matthew 1, 18 to 23, that's exactly how it played out. Because Mary did conceive, and she realized, I've not been with Joseph. I've not physically had any relations with a man. And so she was a virgin that the Holy Spirit overshadowed her, and conception was done because of that rather than the normal process. This was a sign, and the coming Messiah was given because of that. And then we go back again, going back and forth, the promises of reward and punishment for Israel. Deuteronomy chapter 7, there's a lot to be said about the rewards and punishments. The Bible says, then shall come to pass because you listen to these, and these keep to do it, and to do them that the Lord your God will keep with you the covenant and the mercy which he swore to your fathers. And he will love you and bless you and multiply you. He will bless the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your land, their grain and your new wine and your oil, the increase of your cattle and the offspring of your flock in the land which he swore to your fathers to give to you. I couldn't read the top part of that, but you read that and you'll find it reads just the same. So God is saying, I reward you if you do what's right. If you keep my commandments, everything will be well. But what if they didn't do that? Well, the Bible then says, then it shall be if by any means forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and serve them and worship them, I testify against you this day that you shall surely perish. As the nations with the Lord destroys before you, so ye shall perish because you would not be obedient to the voice of the Lord your God. And so he tells them exactly why it would be. These promises were conditional. God was faithful. When they were faithful to him, he did exactly what he said he did. They would prosper and they would have great increase. But when they left God in becoming unfaithful in apostasy, then that's exactly when they would be suffering punishments and other nations would overtake them and even take them into captivity, into Babylonian captivity. Then we see, again, the promises fulfilled. That brings up the time to Jesus and his work and his ministry. Finally, the Messiah has come. Then we see the promises fulfilled. Matthew 21, verse 4, this very familiar statement that Matthew gives so much. He says, all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying. And you see that several times. Matthew is good on showing us the connection from the prophets of the Old Testament and the fulfillment in the New Testament. He makes the connection. He actually kind of puts the dots, the lines together and shows us exactly how that is. And we see Jesus who came and he spoke in parables and talking about the kingdom that he would establish. In Matthew 16, 18, he said, told Peter upon this rock, this confession that Peter just made, Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And we see, talks about in verse 19, about giving Peter the keys to the kingdom, and they would, the binding and the loosing power of this, whatever had been bound in heaven, they would also be bound on earth. And so already that's taking place when in Acts chapter 2, we see the time of the fulfillment of that, that God's faithfulness was there. Every step of the way, the zeal of the Lord's host would perform everything about the setting up of that kingdom. It would not be left to other people, but God would have his kingdom established by his son, Jesus Christ. We can be a part of that kingdom today, can't we? Now I want to talk about very quickly why God's faithfulness is important to us today. I want to tell you that there's some reasons why we need to have the faithfulness of God on our mind and our hearts when we're doing the work that God has given us to do. First of all, as God asks of us about total commitment and devotion and the sacrifices that we do in his name, all of those have to be done because we understand God's faithfulness. That everything we do in sacrifice, everything we give up, everything that we suffer is going to be rewarded. Because God is faithful. We didn't need to know about God's faithfulness to trust him fully. You know, when you put your life on the line for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake, you need to know that what you're doing is something that's going to matter in eternity. And that what you're doing, God doesn't forget those things. You know, God can't forget our faithfulness. He can't forget our evil deeds, but he also cannot forget our faithfulness. That's why the faithfulness of God is important, because we realize he is one that's always there, ready for us. And he sees us when we are doing the things we do for him. In this lesson, a study of ample evidence, truly God is faithful. His faithfulness endures forever. And I want to finish this lesson by saying this. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 20, that he will keep all future promises. We've looked at promises in the past. You know, there's future promise, a home in heaven and the reward, and everything about that is a promise that God's made for us. There's things he said to us specifically and about the things that he does help in the kingdom today. And here I'm going to read what Paul said a long time ago. He says, but as God is faithful, our word to you was not yes and no, for the Son of God, Jesus Christ, was preaching among you by us, by me, Silvanus, and Timothy, was not yes and no. It says there wasn't yes and no, but in him was yes. For all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him, amen, to the glory of God through us. There's a lot of things we understand about this passage. It's talking about, it's not some, well, some things may come true, some may not. It's about the yes and amen. These are confirmed promises that God will do what he says, and he says what he means in those things. And that we need to trust him fully and service to him. Hope you've enjoyed the lesson of the hour. Hope it's been beneficial to you in some way to understand that we can trust the God who created all things and wants us to be saved by faith in him, by repentance of our sins, and confession of Jesus Christ as the Son of God, and baptism for the very remission of your sins. If you've not done that, why not do that today and be faithful to him who is always faithful? Just like that motto the Marines have, Semper Fi, God is always faithful, and he will reward us for the things that we do. Until next time, have a good day, and God bless.